morning. Happy Sunday to you all. What another beautiful, glorious day in the kingdom of our God. He woke us up this morning. He woke us up this morning, and I was so glad. I had to tell myself on this morning, bless the Lord. I had to tell myself, bless the Lord, oh, my soul and everything that is within me. I commanded myself to bless the Lord and forget not his benefits. And how many of you know that there are benefits in serving the Lord God this morning? Well, on every day, there's benefits with serving the Lord God. There's benefits in being in the body of Christ. There's benefits in being his children, as we have learned over the last couple of weeks in the book of Ephesians, that he had predestined, he had made up in his mind that we, the church, was going to be his adopted children, and therefore we have access to his benefits, those blessings that the Bible, that Paul writes to the Ephesian church, those blessings that he has given us, every spiritual blessing. And Paul tells us that they're all located in the heavenly places. So how about you just tell yourself, bless the Lord, oh my soul, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, and forget not his benefits. For this is the day. Don't forget that this is today, today, and every day that the Lord wakes us up, every day that the Lord calls us into his presence, every day, this is the day that the Lord has made. Today is the day that the Lord had predestined, that had ordained before the foundation of the earth for you to be here. This is the day that the Lord has made. Therefore, all of his people, all of God's people, should rejoice and be glad in it. I am so thankful and honored to be here before you. I thank God for you and you all waking up this morning and allowing me in your homes just to share the word of the Lord with you. I do not take it lightly. I do not take it for granted. I really find it to be an honor that you all, there's plenty of people that you could be listening to this morning. There's plenty of other services. We all, this is prime time right here. So there's plenty of people that you could be listening to, but you chose to be here with us at the Lighthouse on the Pike Church. And on behalf of the members of this church, I personally thank every single last one of you. I thank every one of you for tuning in on this morning. We will be continuing, as I mentioned last week, that we're going to go. It wasn't my intentions originally, but we're going to look through this book of Ephesians, Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. We're going to read it, and we're going to go through it anyway as a complete unit to see what the Lord would say to us, his people today, through the Apostle Paul and his letters to the church, his letter to the church at Ephesus. Today we will be looking at the second chapter of the book of Ephesians. We will be going through this whole series as a unit. However you would like to put it. So we're not going to cover everything. And I know sometimes I get excited and I try to squeeze everything into these 45 minutes to an hour. But I'm going to take my time intentionally on this, because Paul is saying some things here in this letter to the church at Ephesus that I believe that through the Spirit of God, through the Holy Spirit, will be a huge blessing and enlightenment and life to you and I today. So for your hearing on this morning, I will be looking at chapter 2, but we will only cover verses 8. Well, I'm going to read verses 8 through 10 today, but for context, we're going to look at verses 1 through 10. But for your hearing, I'm going to read for you, and I'm reading from the ESV. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. And the Bible reads, "For by grace you have been saved through faith." Somebody ought to say amen to that. And we're going to look at that later on, but I just want to read it again because it just sounds so good and it blesses me just hearing it. That for by grace you can say you, somebody say I, make that personal, that by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God. Man, I want to read that again. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And it is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Verse 9, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Father God, I thank you, Lord. I thank you for your people. Lord, I thank you for creating all of us. Lord, I thank you for keeping us here for such a time as this. Lord, for whatever reason that during this space and time and history, Lord, of your creation, that you designed us, those of us who are here today. Lord, you've designed us. You intended for us to be here during this time. You hand selected us to be here during this time in history. And Lord, we are grateful. We are thank you for your choosing of us. Lord, we give you all praises and we give you all honor. Lord, we submit ourselves to you. We humble ourselves before you and we come together on this morning, Lord, that so that we, your people, collectively can hear what it is that you would say to your church. So, Father, it is my prayer that you would open up the eyes and the ears of our hearts so that we may clearly hear and perceive what it is that you would say to us, Lord. Well, by your Spirit, we ask that you would remove, Lord, any hindrances, Lord. Lord, that you would bring our minds into oneness with and bring it into unity with one another and you, Lord, even though we may be separated. We're not in the sanctuary together, but Lord, we are in our sanctuaries, Lord, for we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So, Father, we ask that you would speak to us and give us clarity, give us depth, give us understanding, Lord, give us wisdom, give us knowledge, Lord, in who you are and who we are to you, and Lord, how your word applies to us on today. Lord, please remove any hindrances. Lord, any sickness, Lord, any hurt, any anger, Lord, any letdowns, Lord, anything that would be a hindrance to your people on today, Father, would you remove it in the name of Jesus? Now, Lord, also before we go, Father, would you, after this service is over, Lord, as we continue out the rest of our day, Lord, as we continue out the rest of this week, Lord, would you teach us to be better doers of your word and not just forget Sunday and being hearers only? Lord, would you teach us to be better doers of your word? Father, this is my prayer, and I ask these things in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, I pray. Amen. Verse 8 through 10, chapter 2 of the book of Ephesians, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Not a result of works, so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Last week and the week before, I titled the previous two messages, Read the Fine Print, Read the Fine Print. And I thought it was appropriate in labeling it as that because as believers, we've all, if we call ourselves believers, we all have gone through the process in which I mean by that we have accepted the Lord Jesus as our Savior, and we say that we are saved. We say that we are saved, and I wholeheartedly believe that we are. We have joined congregations or churches, and we understand. I know that we all understand that the church that we attend is just a building, but we've also grown to understand that we are the believers are, that we are the church, that we are the church. We have grown to know that collectively we are, as Paul speaks here, that we are the body of Christ, and Christ is the head, which is the whole theme of this letter to Ephesians, that being that the church with Christ as the head, the body with Christ as the head, as meaning that we, the church, that we believe in submissive, that we are submitted to Christ, that Christ is our head, that Christ is our Lord. So therefore, I thought it was appropriate to title this and now what would look to be this series as Read the Fine Print, because I spoke about that oftentimes, just like we've in the past or in our natural lives anyway, that we've signed some legal documents, whether you made some purchases or you went into an agreement with something. And likewise, that is what the covenant is, that we have gone into covenant relationship with God, that there's an agreement here that's made. And we've all read the large print. We understand, as I mentioned, we understand it. Yes, I believe in my heart, and I have confessed with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus died for my sin, that Jesus not only died, but on the third day, he resurrected. He resurrected and then he ascended with the Father. We have grown to understand that the Lord Jesus, before he left his disciples, he says that I am going to the Father, but I will be in you, and that he is in me, or that I am in the Father, that he is in me, that you are in me, that we are in you, and where I go, that you will go also. So we have grown to understand some of the large print of our belief, those things that that we know, that we've said it so many times, that even in most cases that we've read it. But have we read the fine print? Have we looked at all of the benefits that we have in Christ Jesus? And so much so that we see even in Psalm 103 that David writes in that psalm in the opening, he says, "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, and forget not his benefits." There are benefits. There are benefits in Christ Jesus. And what we have found thus far, that what we have found out thus far in the book of Ephesians, just in chapter one alone, remember I said that in these short six chapters, please, I encourage you all, if you have not read the book of Ephesians, read it in its totality. I know that the book of Ephesians, that we, as always, as in all of the Bible, that we pull out our favorite verses and things that we've quoted. But let's look at the whole letter of Ephesians. Let's look at it as one unit. I know that we want to immediately jump to chapter 6 about putting on the whole armor of God, or some of us would like to jump to chapter 4 and speak about the fivefold ministry. But there's benefits, and again, I call that the large print. Those are the things that we are familiar with. Those are the things that we have quoted and heard over and over again, but we miss the fine print. Why is Paul speaking of the prophet and the apostles and the evangelists and the teachers and the preachers? Why is Paul talking about putting on the whole armor of God, which is the whole climax of the particular story of this letter? But what we see here is that Paul started off in this letter saying that we, or the church at Ephesus, that God has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, is how Paul opens up this letter. So we see that the letter is climaxing. Paul is making an argument. And in these short six chapters, the first three of the chapters, as I previously mentioned, is very doctrinal, if you will, very doctrinal and as well theological. We learn a lot. As a matter of fact, some of the primary doctrines of our churches and what we believe, we find right here in the first three chapters of the book of Ephesians. As a matter of fact, one of the most important foundational things about what it is that we believe as from a doctrinal perspective is found right in chapter one. Right in chapter one, we see the Trinity. We see that Paul talks about that the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus, and he talks about how we, his people, are sealed in the Holy Spirit. So we see right there, we see God the Father, we see God the Son and Jesus, and we see the Holy Spirit. So that right there alone is enough. It should inspire us enough to know what Paul, the Apostle Paul, would have to say about those things. But so far, here's what we've learned from chapter one to bring us to bring us up to speed in our text on today. So far, we have learned that we, the believers, the church, has been blessed by God, as I just said, by God the Father in Jesus Christ, with every spiritual blessings. And where are these spiritual blessings? Paul says that these spiritual blessings are in the heavenly places. We have learned thus far that he, God, being God, chose us. We are God's sovereign choice. We are God's sovereign choice. If you ever wondered, does God care about you? If you've ever wondered, does God think about you? I need for you to know today that we, the church, today, if you are a believer, that you are God's sovereign choice. We have learned thus far in chapter one that he, being God, chose us, chose the church, chose the body of Christ in him before the foundation of the world. And not only has he chose us before the foundation of the world, that he had predestined us. He had predestined us before you were even born, before you had made any, have ever made any right or wrong choice, that before God said, let there be, before Genesis chapter one, where in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, before any of that happened, that God had already made up in his mind that he had chose you, he had chose us, he had chosen his church for adoption through Christ Jesus according to his purpose and according to his will. What we've learned thus far in chapter one is that we, believers, the church, that when, the day that we believed in him, that day that we believed in him, that we were already sealed, that we were sealed with the Holy Spirit. I'll say that again, that when we came to know him, that when we came to believe in him on that day, that we were sealed with the Holy Spirit, and that this sealing, if you will, this marking of the Holy Spirit was done in order to guarantee. The Holy Spirit has been given to us as a down payment. God makes a down payment and not for us, even though here it is again. That's the fine print, that these are things that we benefit from. But God himself has sealed us with his Holy Spirit as a guarantee of our inheritance until the day that we acquire it. Or here's a better way, or here's a simpler, easy way of looking at that. God has sealed us. God has sealed us, that therefore, to that, that is a guarantee that nothing, no one, not an idea, there's nothing that can separate us. There it is. That's what I'm after, that Paul wrote in the book of Romans, that there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. There's nothing that can, or no one, there's not a power or a force that we see just shortly here that can separate us from the love of God. There's nothing that can pull us out of his hand. Therefore, that we, the church, the day that we were believed, we were sealed with the Holy Spirit as a down payment of our inheritance, this inheritance that we're adopted sons and daughters, that we're adopted children of God, and the Holy Spirit seals us until that day that we acquire or possession of it, until that day that we go to be with him and to be with the Lord forever. The Holy Spirit has been given to us to seal us, to guarantee that that day will happen. We have learned thus far, I'm getting happy, I'm getting excited, just going back, just reviewing. We have learned already in chapter one that we should always pray. I'll say that again, that we should always pray. Now, here's Paul was very specific in the things that he prayed for the believers. And this section is where we were at last week, that I told you that Paul in the second section of chapter one was ultimately praying for the maturity of the church. He was praying. He had given blessings to the church. He praised the church for their love and their action toward one another, and that they had great faith. But Paul was praying for maturity in the church. And likewise, if we are to follow the Apostle Paul, that we should always pray not only for ourselves, but we should pray for one another continuously, that the Lord God will give us, his people, the spirit of wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of him. I'll say that for you again, that we, the church, that we should be like the Apostle Paul, and that we should always pray not only for ourselves, but for one another, that God would give us the spirit of wisdom. The Apostle James writes in the book of James that if any of you lack wisdom, ask God, who gives to all generously. And likewise, we should pray for ourselves that God would give us as individuals wisdom. But likewise, we should pray for one another that God the Father would give us all the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of who he is. We have learned in chapter one, just in chapter one, we haven't even gotten all the way. We just get into chapter two today. We have learned that this knowledge and revelation of him reveals to believers, to the church, that God's immeasurable greatness of power that he worked in Christ Jesus, he also worked in us. I'll say that again, because that just blows my mind every time I think about it. We learned in chapter one in this letter to Ephesus, to the church in Ephesus, that the knowledge that Paul prayed for the church, the knowledge of who he is, the revelation of who he is, and the spirit of wisdom, this understanding of who he is, this knowledge of revelation of him reveals that God's immeasurable greatness of power. You can't even measure. It is immeasurable, the greatness and the glory of God's power, that same power that he worked in Christ Jesus, because we are in Christ, Paul says. That's therefore, that same power that he worked in Christ Jesus, he also worked in us. That means you and I, like the church in Ephesus, the power of the revelation of who Jesus Christ is, that same power that God worked in Christ Jesus, he has also worked in the church, because we, the church, the body that Paul tells us that we are in Christ. Jesus says that we are in him. So now he has worked that same power in us, and that these same riches and that these same blessings that are in Christ, that it surpasses any earthly or wealth power. I'll say that again, that the same power that was manifested in Christ, the Lord has now manifested it, because we are in Christ. He has manifested it in the church. And because of that, the same riches and blessings that are in Christ, that it far surpasses any earthly wealth or any earthly ruler. What we learned in chapter one, that the revelation of who Jesus Christ is, and that who Jesus Christ is in us, that he has been given power and authority over all rulers, or he is higher and more, and the power of his riches far surpasses any earthly riches. All of these, what we have learned here, all of these great riches are part of the package, a part of the benefit package that we receive. See, we're not just saved. And yes, we are saved in the sense of, like, yes, the death of Jesus Christ has saved us from the wrath of God that we all owed him because of our sinful nature. But there are benefits in being in Christ Jesus. If all we received because of what Christ did for us, if all we received was that, yes, we get to be with him forever, that would have been enough for me. But God, there were benefits. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not his benefits. We got to read the fine print, because there are benefits in this, that all of these great riches that we talk about, this immeasurable greatness of the power that God worked in Jesus Christ, was part of the benefits package of salvation. I thought somebody would say amen to that. And we have received such a lucrative benefit package. This lucrative benefit package that we received might just cause some believers to boast about their salvation. And what do I mean about boast about salvation? Should we be glad that we have salvation and that we have received salvation from Jesus Christ? Absolutely, yes. But having such a lucrative benefit package, having such knowledge in these great mysteries of God, might just cause one to boast about their salvation, or boast about the gift that has been given to them, as if it was their own doing, as if it was their own, as if they did it themselves, thus taking away the glory of God and receiving the glory for themselves. You all, if you've been in church any amount of time, you've heard the lingo that we use. You've heard the lingo that we use, speech that we use in church, when we say words like my anointing. my anointing. We say things like my spirit. We say things like my teachings. We say things like my gifts. As if any one of us, we even say things like, I found Jesus. Jesus was never lost. We were. But the point of what I'm getting at is that whether we do it intentionally or not, having some revelation of the Lord revealing some of these things to us may cause us to be puffed up. And we begin to look at it as if our righteousness is of ourselves, and we forget that our righteousness is only of Christ Jesus. We are saved, Paul said in verse 8, and I don't want to jump ahead of myself, that Paul said it is by grace, it's by God's love that we have been saved. It is through faith that we have been saved. And he says that this is not done on your own doing. And that brings us to the point of our text today, because Paul in chapter 2 is reminding the church. Paul is bringing it, and Paul is possibly, in our text today, it's not possibly, Paul is actually putting a rest to the thought that any one person, that any one of us may boast on human salvation as if it was a work of our own. That Paul is putting a rest to that today, that we can only boast in Christ because we are in Christ. In our text today, opening up at verse 1 or beginning at verse 1 in chapter 2, Paul says to the church, and you were dead in the trespass and in sins. Now notice that the first word is and. Now any of us, you should know that you can't start a sentence with and. You can't begin an idea with and, which tells us that chapter 2 is a continuation of chapter 1. Chapter 2 is a continuation of chapter 1. Now, when Paul wrote this letter, there was no such thing as chapters and verses. That has been added at a later date. So therefore, we can find points in our Bible. We can reference certain things. But in Paul's letter, that wasn't there. And for the most part, our Bible does a good job with separating sections and ideas and adding the subtitles, giving us readers an understanding of what Paul or any other one of the gospel writers is talking about in that section. But sometimes they have missed it. Sometimes they will create a new idea in a new subtitle. And even though in this section, Paul is going to begin to talk about grace through faith. But what we can learn from this is that when we get to chapter 2, this is not a new idea. Paul is actually getting to the point of his original thought that he was speaking about in the latter half of chapter 1, beginning at verse 15, and why he was praying for the saints and for their maturity, because he was praying that we, the church, that will grow and know the hope to which that God has called us, and that we would know that what are the riches of his glorious inheritance that he has given to the saints. He was praying that we would learn that Christ and the authority that has been given to Christ is far above all rule, all authority, all power, and all dominion. He says now in verse 1 of chapter 2, he says now, and you were dead. And you were dead. If we read verse 23 of chapter 1 and continue on to verse 1 of chapter 2, it may read something like this. He says that, and he put all things under his feet, being Christ, and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. And he says, and you, being the church, he says, watch this, and you were dead in trespass and sins in which you once walked. Paul tells the church that they were dead, that they were depraved in the actions of their sins in which they once walked or in which they once lived, he says. Now, why is this? He tells the church at Ephesus, and likewise, this is for you and I today, that before we said yes to Christ, before we believed in him, before we confessed with our mouth, before that glorious day took place, that prior to that, that we were dead. Pastor G, how we were dead, we were alive. No. We were dead. We were depraved. We had no longing. We had no desire for God. Even though a lot of us grew up and I'm doing air quotes here, Christian homes, all of us grew up, we had some knowledge, some information, we had some awareness of him, but the truth of the matter is, prior to us saying yes to Christ, we were walking dead. We were, yes, we were physically alive, but spiritually we were dead. We were separated from God because of our sinful nature, which is why we have words like atonement. We were now, because of the blood of Jesus Christ, that the blood of Jesus Christ was an atonement or a payment that now reconciled us or allowed us access to God. Because prior to that, prior to us acknowledging Jesus, prior to us believing and confessing him, Paul says, the second chapter of Ephesians, verse 1, that you were dead. We were dead in trespasses and sin. We were dead is an easier, simpler way to say that we were dead in sin. He says, in which you once walked. We all, every single last one of us, we were once dead. Paul says, and this is how you lived, that you followed the course of this world. That we followed, that we were led by, that we were influenced by the very breath or air of this world. There was a course that was set in place that you followed, that I followed, that we followed. Remember, Paul even talks about in the book of Romans, to the church in Rome, that they were slaves to sin, that sin had authority over them, that sin had lordship over them, that sin had mastery over them. Likewise, we see here that there was a time in you and I's life that we actually walked. We lived according to the course that was set in place by this world. But watch this. This world, Paul says, or it reads, in which you once walked following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. Here's what Paul is saying, that we once were governed by a course that was set in place by the principles of the world that was set according to the principles, or that was following the course of the prince of the air. It is key here that we understand what is Paul talking about, because the following that we follow, or we were governed by, we were led by the course of the world that we're currently, that we were living in at that time, and the same world that is currently in place now. Let's put it all together, because we lived according to the course of the world, which was according to the following of the prince of the power of the air. And when we look at this in its text, or in its original text, it is referring to the devil or demonic spirits, who the devil is referred to as the prince of the air, or the prince of the demons, the prince of the demons. So we're talking about, just like there's angels and an angelic host, there the world or the devil and his angels was sent or punished or banished to earth. There, so he's referred to the devil or the prince of the air, the prince of demons. So look at it in this text, that you, I, we once walked under leadership or under influence of demonic presence. And these were the things that governed us. And Paul says that same prince of the air, that same demonic influence of the world that governed you, he says that same spirit is now at work in the sons of disobedience. So here we are. Before we began to look at ourselves as so lofty and as so high and as and like we saved ourselves and like we created the earth, Paul is bringing to remembrance of the church that we should remain humble. Paul is talking to the church in Ephesus, reminding them, remember from verse 15, when he began to thank God for them and he was praying continuously for their maturity. Paul is now saying that here's another way. Here's another thing to put on our list, how we can see our growth and our maturity in the Lord Christ, because we once we start thinking more higher than ourselves than we are, once we exalt ourselves and forget the fact that there was a time that we, now that like we're led by Christ, or we should be, like we're led by Christ, we were also led by demons. We were also influenced by demons. Just like we have this leading of the Holy Spirit, like, no, there was a time where you and I, we governed our life, we lived our life by the leading of demonic activity, those things that are enemies of the kingdom of God. Paul says, likewise, that those same, that same prince of the air is at work in the sons of disobedience, referring to or making reference to those who are not in Christ. See, we, in verse 1, in chapter 1, we were told that, like, now we were adopted. We were adopted now through Christ Jesus, through the redemption of the blood, through the redemption of the blood, that God adopted us. He took authority over us. He now allows us in him through Christ Jesus, that he adopted us, and we're no longer sons and daughters of the prince of the air. But that same prince of the air has children. Those who are unbelievers has children that are still influenced by him. And Paul says, you were once those. You were once those sons and daughters of disobedience. And we see it right here in verse 3. He says, among whom we all, he includes himself. For those of you who think that you was just born saved, Paul says, among whom once we all lived in the passions of our flesh. We all lived according to those strong desires. The lust of our flesh. Paul, the James writes in James, in chapter 1 of the book of James, that when a man is tempted, that he is dragged away and enticed by his own desires. So how is it that you can say that the devil made you do it? No, you were influenced by him, but he has the ability to influence you by those things that you hold and abhor in your heart, those things that are your desires, those things that lived in every single last one of us. And Paul says that there was a time that we all were sons of, if we just read it for what it is, that we all were sons and daughters of the devil. He says, amongst whom we all once lived, we lived in. So look at the comparison and contrast, because heretofore we see that we are in Christ, that we live in Christ, or we are seated in high places, in heavenly places with Christ. Paul here says that that when we were sons of disobedience, we lived in. We were governed by, our life was in accordance with the passions of our flesh. Therefore, because that's where we dwelled, therefore, like we, when we lived in the passions of our flesh, we thus carried out the desires of the flesh, or the desires of the body. Meaning that, watch this, when we talk about the sinful nature, when we talk about sin, Paul's, look at the difference. It would appear to be the same word, and it is, but contextually it's different, because Paul says here that you, being the church at Ephesus, which was now us at all, he says, but then he includes himself, that we all, he says that we all once lived in the passions of our flesh. We lived in the desires. That's how we dwelt. That's how we thought. That's how we governed ourselves. We were influenced by. We had been enticed by. We lived in those things. And because that's how we thought, those were the things that was in our heart, he says that you carried out, that we carried out the desires. So sin within itself, the nature of sin, is the actual place that we live. That's who we are in our nature, but it starts there. But then there's the action of sin, that we actually carry those desires out. So he says that you lived in the passions of your flesh, thus carrying out the desires of your body or flesh. Some translations read, he says, so you carried out the desires of your body and the mind. Here we are. That's why the Bible says that as a man thinks, so is he. That's why the Bible says to renew our minds daily. That's why the Bible says that where a man's heart is, there his treasure will be also. We see that we once lived out the passions of not only our flesh, but also the passions of our mind. And that's why Paul also talks about in the book of Romans that the spirit and the flesh are at war with one another. Why? For control over our mind, because it's how we think. How we think is what's going to govern what we do. So that's why Paul says that we should walk in the spirit, walk according to the spirit. Therefore, we will not carry out the lustful desires of our flesh. The flesh and the spirit are constantly at war with one another. The spirit desires to do the things of God. Our flesh still has connectivity with this world and its worldly passions and the prince of the air. So our flesh likes those things. Our flesh desires those things. Our flesh lusts after those things, but our spirit desires the things of God, and they're both at war with one another for control over our mind. And Paul says that at one time there was no battle. At one time we were governed, we were children of the prince of the air. Therefore, we carried out all of our fleshly passions and carried out the desires of our body and our mind. Thus, he says, and we were by nature, if we were born in it, by nature, we were children of wrath, meaning that we were born, we were children to the prince of the air. Thus, we were going to receive God's wrath. He says, watch this, oh my God, that and by nature, we were children of wrath like the rest of mankind. We can't look down our noses at sinners or the world. We're not more greater than them, for we once was them. Therefore, we cannot boast in or take or we cannot boast in or we cannot take credit for the things that the Lord God has done and that can only be done through Christ Jesus. He says we were once by nature children of wrath, just like the rest of mankind. See, I know this is the fine print. Yeah, there are some benefits in God, and this is all beneficial because we need to know that all of these things are only found in Christ and not in us. But here's the thing: we don't like to think of ourselves as that. We dress ourselves up. We do all of that because we don't want to see us for who we really are. But you all have heard me say it, and I will say it until Christ come. That apart from Jesus Christ, and you all have to get to this place to admit that apart from Jesus Christ, I am a sinner. I am a sinner. Apart from Jesus Christ, I am a sinner. My righteousness is of that of filthy rags. Let's go on, because we got to get to verse four is our blessing. Verse 4 says this, but see, if you read it together, that we in which you once walked, we were dead in our trespasses and sins, following the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of our body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Verse 4, But God, I thank the Lord. But God, him being rich in mercy, you know mercy. The Bible says, Paul writes, that God is rich in mercy. that God is a billionaire, a quadrillionaire, whatever. Paul, that God is rich in mercy. But God, who is rich in mercy, watch this, because of the great love with which he loved us, that even when we were dead in our trespass, those times when the Lord should have killed us, those times where the Lord should have let some of those situations that we were in overtake us. Those times where the Lord should have judged us, and rightfully so, whatever would have happened to us would have been a righteous judgment by God. And it was in those times that the Lord, in his rich mercy, gave us mercy, the Bible says in verse 4, that God, being rich in mercy because of his great love in which he loved us, even when we were dead, in God's mind, he made us alive. Watch this. No, we were walking dead in our sin and in our trespasses. And God loved you. God loved me. God loved us so much that even when we were dead, even when we were children of wrath, even when we rightly deserved whatever it was that should have happened to us and could have happened to us, God showed us mercy. And it was right then and there, while we were dead, while we were guilty. That God made us alive together in Christ. See, this is the beauty, this is the power that Paul talked and prayed about that we would understand in the resurrection. Because what we fail to remember, I don't even want to say that we don't know, but I think we just say it so much that when we talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, when we talk about the death of Jesus Christ, I know Resurrection Sunday will be here in 2 weeks. And we're so busy. We're so busy preparing for Easter. We're so busy about teaching our children. That ain't even what I'm after. But we're so busy teaching our children about Easter bunnies. We're so busy about doing all of these other things that has absolutely nothing to do with the resurrection of our Lord. What we should be celebrating, what we should be thankful about, is that when Jesus Christ got up out of the grave for a crime that he was put to death for, that he did not commit, but he had to do it in order to pay the ransom that we owe God and could not afford to give him, that when Jesus Christ got out of the grave because we were dead, remember, on the cross, Jesus bore the sins of all man, past, present, and future, of those who would believe in him. He bore the sins. He that knew no sin became sin. Thus, if we look at it according to this text, he became a child of God's wrath in your and I and my place. He became a child of God's wrath, and God gave us mercy, but God charged him with the penalty. I'll say it again, that God gave you and I mercy, but he found Christ guilty of all sins committed. Therefore, he was sentenced to death on the cross. He was sentenced to death on the cross. So when he was on the cross, all of those things that you remember that you did, I give you a second to think about it. I don't want you to go back too far. All of those things that nobody knows about, all of those things that I did that you all don't know about, that I thought that I was able to hide. Everything that you could ever think of that you've ever done, everything that you've ever thought, the very nature in which you were born in, Jesus took that to the cross. God charged him guilty. He was guilty as charged. He took it to the cross and he was sentenced to death. But right here, what we see Paul is saying, because God was rich in his mercy for us, he was rich in mercy for us, but he found Christ guilty. He found Jesus guilty. But because of his great love for us, in which he loved us, while we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together in Christ. So God didn't leave his Holy One in the grave to see corruption. Jesus got up on the third day. I should be preaching this on Resurrection Sunday. Jesus arose out of the grave. So he found Jesus guilty for your and I sins. And Paul tells us that when Jesus got out of the grave, that we were resurrected with him. Somebody should be right there in your living room, in your bedroom, wherever you at. Somebody should be screaming amen, because verse 5 says that even when we were dead, while we were walking around, we were walking dead men and women. We were walking dead in our trespasses. that God made us alive together with Christ. We were children of wrath. We deserve the penalty of God's judgment. But because God had mercy on us, while we were dead, watch this, while we were dead, God made us alive. God made us alive. We were dead. God made us alive together with Christ. So watch this. He says in verse 5, by grace you have been saved. What's grace? God's love for us. It's right there in verse 4. But God being rich in mercy because of not just some minimal level of love, but because of the great love with which he loved us, that even while we were dead in our sins, God made us alive together with Christ. He says, by grace, by the Lord's love that we did not deserve, we have been saved. Watch this. I've said it already. I was ahead of myself. Because verse 6 tells us, by grace, we were saved. By his mercy, he made us alive while we were dead. That's cool. Write that down. Write it in this order. By his mercy, he made us alive while we were dead. By his grace, he saved us. And by his grace, he raised us up with Christ. Don't just stop there. He raised us up with him. Not only did he raise us up, when Christ ascended into heaven, watch this, because there's an and right there too, and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Jesus says, where I go, you will be there also. Paul tells us that by God's mercy, he made us alive when we were walking around dead. But by his grace, he saved us from the penalty because, watch this, when he was showing us mercy, he was placing judgment on Jesus. He showed us mercy, found Christ guilty, found Jesus guilty. But then he gave us grace. And when he rewarded Jesus for his obedience, which, if we look at it, would have been deserving, you and I now fall in on his grace because we don't deserve it. He got the penalty. We don't deserve it. But now when he took Christ out of the grave, now he gave us what we didn't deserve, and now we have the benefits. We got to read the fine print that now we have the benefits of the resurrection in Christ Jesus. And if that's not enough, no, wait, there's more. Not only do he bring us out of death, Jesus resurrected. So he made us, when Jesus resurrected, he made us alive. He made us alive. Jesus resurrected. So now we have been not only saved when Jesus went to the cross, which was a factor of grace. Also by his grace, he raised Jesus. When he raised Jesus from the dead, he raised us from the dead as well. And if that's not enough, again, wait, there's more. He also seated us with Christ in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And he tells us why. Paul tells us why here in verse 7. He says, so that, here's the reason why. Here's the answer on why God did that. That in the coming of ages, he might show his immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. He did all of this before we ever committed any wrong. He did all of this in his mind before these days happened. So in order that, verse 7, so that in the coming of ages or in the coming of time, that he might show his immeasurable riches of grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. What just happened here? That before the foundation of the world, the Lamb had been slain. Jesus, in the mind of God, these things were already going to happen. Remember, we saw back in first one that we are chosen, that we are predestined, that the Lord God chose us in him before the foundation of the world. So before anything wrong had happened, before Eve ate of the apple, not the apple, oh my gosh, I don't believe I said that, before Eve ate of the fruit, Bible don't say apple. We were taught that in school. We saw little pictures. Before Eve violated the commandments of God and ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, before Eve shared it with her husband Adam, and before Adam partook in it, and before they tried to hide from God when he called out for them, before Cain killed Abel, before the earth had tasted any blood, we see right here that God had chose us before the foundation of the world. He had predestined us to be adopted children. We see here that in the mind of God, when all the, this is what Paul is doing, he's explaining of what took place before anything that had happened, that God had already made up in his mind. And Paul goes back and gives us a precursor, if you will. He gives us a prequel. He gives us a story. Then he gives us a prequel. Then he brings us back up to speed of where we currently live. So we see that before the foundation of the world, he talked about how we once lived in sin. He talked about how God saved us from our death. But then he also says that here, that God had made, that did these things before the foundation of the world, so that in the coming of ages, when it was time, that God, that we actually lived in our present time, or in Paul's present time, and for us today, that when those days came about, what's today's date? That when March 20th, 2021 came about, that God might show his immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus, that whatever day that God's creation, his people, or people was going to come about, that in those ages, and even for times past us, even when Jesus is going to come back for us, because remember, we also saw in chapter 1 that we have not inherited it just yet, that the Holy Spirit seals us, but in the coming of ages, God did all of this. This was already in God's plan. So that in the coming of ages, that he would now manifest himself. He would manifest his, watch this, his immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us. That when those days will come, the days of past and Paul's time, our current days and the days of future, that God had already did all of this. This was all part of God's working, that in the days to come, in the ages to come, that God would reveal, he would show his immeasurable riches of his grace. We'll find out. We find out just how rich God is in grace. There's not a person that you could think of. Not Elon Musk. There's not a person that you can, not Jeff Bezos, not Bill Gates, not Warren Buffett. There's not a person that you could think of, not Oprah, not a person that you can think of. Their riches does not surpass God's riches just in his grace alone. So in the days or the ages to come, that God would reveal or show his immeasurable riches of grace to us in Christ Jesus, which brings us to our verse today. We're almost done. Verse 8. For by grace, what grace? God's grace. For by grace, you have been saved. By grace, not only have you been saved, but how did it happen? Through faith. You didn't hear what I just said. By grace, you and I, Paul and the church at Ephesus, by grace, you have been saved through or by way of faith. Look at the next sentence. Because you thought that it said, by your faith, God saved you by his grace. That's not what it says. I'll say it again. I'll read it again. For by grace you have been saved through faith. You thought that just said that this is how you're hearing it. This is how I heard it. This is how we all hear it. This is how it's been taught to us. Watch this. You think that it says, for by grace, we understand that's by God's grace. Let me add the words into it, because this is how we interpret it. For by grace, you have been saved by your faith. By grace, we have been saved by our faith, by our belief in him. That's what we thought that it says, but it doesn't say that. Pastor G, you crazy. It does say it. No, it don't. It says, by grace, you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is a gift from God. Well, sure, the grace is a gift from God. No, the faith is a gift from God. Because what we read in the first two verses of chapter 2 is that we were dead. We were depraved in our sin, in which we lived in which we walked. There was nothing about us that desired God, nothing in our sinful nature. He says in verse 3 that by nature alone that we were children of God's wrath. If we add that, see, this is why we... If we add that to what we've already learned in chapter 1, that before the foundation of the world, God knowing all of this, that God had already chosen us. He had predestined us for this. Therefore, there was nothing about us that would have ever had faith to believe in Jesus Christ. The gift, the faith itself for us to believe was a gift from God. Why do you say that? Because it's right here in verse 9. Not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Remember, I said Paul is praying in verse 15 of chapter 1 for the maturity of the saints, that they would continue to grow in the wisdom and the knowledge of God, having their hearts enlightened about the hope and the riches of the glorious inheritance of the saints, about the working of Christ and how Christ is, how God has seated Christ in high places, in heavenly places, which is where he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings so that he will have rule and authority over all power and dominion. He says, and that we were once dead, we were depraved, we were separated, we were alienated from God. We were children of wrath. There's nothing about us that would desire us, but because God, who is rich in his mercies, he found Christ guilty, and while we were dead, he made us alive in him. He made us alive in him. And God had set these things in place. Now, when we even look at the book of Romans, where it says that if you believe in your heart and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, Jesus really gives us the real blueprint of it. He says that no man comes to the Son unless the Father draws him. I don't know what God was doing. I don't know what that chemically looks like. I don't know the breakdown. I don't have the blueprint. I don't have the statistics. I know that scholars argue about that. People believe this and people believe that. We like to say that it's human will. It's our will. No, it was right here. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. We played no part in it. We played no part in it. I know. And I told you, man, the book of Ephesians is so heavy. It's so heavy. And no, we're not going to get all of this today. The book of Ephesians is so heavy. The first three chapters alone, we're just in the first half of chapter 2, is full of what, and regardless of your denominational beliefs, but these things in the book of Ephesians are the foundation of our doctrinal beliefs and theological stances about what we believe about our faith. It's the difference. It's the difference between monergism and synergism. Pastor G, what are you talking about? Monergism, the theological doctrine that God alone rescues sinners through the Holy Spirit to bring about salvation, and it's a part of any individual cooperation or synergism that human will cooperates with God's grace in order to be regenerated. This whole doctrine of how we become justified, the doctrine of justification, sanctification, and glorification. We were justified in believing in Christ. Right now, we're being sanctified. And on the day when Jesus Christ comes, we will be glorified with him only because we're in him. I know that was that comeback. Verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Verse 9, Paul tells us, not a result of works. Nothing that you did. Nothing that I did. Nothing that Paul did. Nothing that the church at Ephesus did. Nothing that the church at Corinth did. Nothing that the church at Philippi did. Not a result of works. So that no man may boast. For we, the church, the body of Christ, we are his workmanship. We are his creation. Created in Christ Jesus for good works. We are his workmanship. Therefore, we can't boast. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. God created us. He created you. He handcrafted you. You are a result. You're listening right now. You believe in Jesus Christ. You are adopted as a son of God, as a daughter of God. You have been adopted or engrafted in the body of Christ because God created you in Christ Jesus for good works. Pastor G, you making this up? Nope, it's a comma right there. The sentence is not over. Which God prepared beforehand. It's right there, read it. Do the work. Look it up, which God prepared beforehand, comma, Paul is still, he's still continuing his thought, that we should walk in them. Not should as a suggestion, should that we will walk in them. For by grace, you have been saved through faith, and it is not your own doing. It is not your grace. It's his grace. Yes, you've had faith, but he gave you that faith, for all man has been given a measure of faith. So it is not your own doing. It is the singular. It is the gift of God. It's in the small print. Read the fine print. It is the gift of God, verse 9, not a result of works, so that none of us may boast. For we are his workmanship. We are his creation, created in Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we shall walk in them, or that we shall live according to the good works that God created for us to do, and no longer walk dead in our trespasses. What Paul is telling us today in this short section, and it just doesn't stop here, because next week we're going to look at verse 11, which starts off with therefore, which Paul is going to make a conclusion to what he told to us today. So please, I hope, man, this is just like a good TV series that cut off right at the good part. But I'll give you a preview. I'll give you a preview. You know, they always give us a preview. Therefore, remember. And I'll stop right there. Therefore, remember. Paul is going to give us the conclusion of that section on next week. But I pray that you read it right now and read it on to next week. Because here's what we find out in the concluding of this section of chapter 2, which is a conclusion of Paul's thanksgiving and prayer in verse 15 of chapter 1, that Paul is praying for maturity in the church. And maturity can be measured by this. We can use this as a ruler, if you will, to measure whether or not we have matured or we are maturing. We can first look at it by looking at the things that we pray for and how we pray. Are we praying just for ourselves from a selfish posture, or are we praying because we should pray for ourselves, but are we also praying for one another? Are we praying for earthly things, or are we praying for things and the blessings of all spiritual blessings that the Lord God has granted us in the heavenly places? You know, those things that are surpasses just these earthly prayers and earthly desires, those things that will last for eternity, those things that are of God, those things that rust and moss cannot destroy, nor can a robber steal. We can look at what we are praying for, and are we praying for revelation and knowledge and wisdom of Him and the power of His glorious inheritance and His immeasurable greatness? Are we praying for those things? We can measure our maturity, our growth by that. And then we can also measure whether or not we're maturing as believers or not, if we're still walking around boasting about ourselves, boasting as if we have the ability to save us or someone else. You know, I'll just add that to the list. You know, I saved 5 people. No, you didn't. You didn't save yourself. It was already in the mind. It was already in the plan of God. We see it right here before the foundation of the world. Are you reading the fine print? Are you reading the fine print? Because right here we see that we were saved by grace through faith, and it is not our own doing. It is by or through the gift of God in Jesus Christ. That's not a result of our works, so that no man can boast. Father God, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. Lord, this word is a little tough today. I'm even like Peter in his writing, that Paul says some hard things. But Lord, by your spirit, if I fumbled over this, if I'm not clear in my flesh, Lord, by your spirit, give us, lead us to all truth and all understanding. Lord, it is the letter kills, but it is your spirit that gives life. So Father, would you minister to your people? Lord, would you stretch us? This just reading it alone is stretching us in our beliefs. Lord, would you stretch us a little bit, grow us, mature us in the wisdom and the knowledge of your word, of who we are in Christ Jesus, that's according to your purpose and your will. Lord, I'm just asking that you would give us understanding, and Lord, that you would teach us how to live this thing out. Father God, I thank you, and I ask these things in the name of your son, Christ Jesus, I pray. Amen. Whew, I just got a headache, y'all, but this is good to me. This is good to me. This is good to me. I know that I threw out some words, synergism and monergism, and we talked about predestination and election. We talked about the Trinity, and I understand it depends on every single, all of us, we're at different places in our walk, in our knowledge of the word and the knowledge of our Lord. Some of us, we just got saved, and we happy to be saved, and that's good. That's great. Wherever we are in our walks, this word is still for you, because Paul is calling the church to a place of maturity, and we can't look down on others who may not have reached, quote unquote, whatever level that we believe that we've come to, because even for those of us that have received some knowledge of who he is, and there is no new revelation, but the revelation in his word, as far as it being revealed to us, whatever state that we have only received that, even if we're walking in whatever gifts, those are gifts. Faith is a gift within itself. Grace is a gift. God's love is a gift. The Holy Spirit is a gift. These are things that God has given us. So we have no right to look down on other people, because we're going to see ultimately what God's purpose is in all of this. And we've already answered it 2 weeks ago, because God desires to use the church. He desires to use the church as his witness against those powers in the heavenly places. So here we are. We'll look at the rest of this over the next coming weeks. I pray. I say all that to say that don't be discouraged if I've said something that you may not understand. If I've said something that challenges your theology, don't get mad at it. Don't tune me out. Send an email. Give me a call. Most of you all have my number, for those of you who I know who watch anyway. And let's discuss the word. Let's ask those questions. That's what Bible study is for. That's what our virtual fellowship is for. Prayerfully, these things have challenged you to go and dig and dive deeper in your word. I can ramble on about that all day. If you do not know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, if you feel that tugging, that pulling, you want to know more about him, you want to be a son, you want to be a daughter, that's not me. I don't have that ability. I can't save you. Jesus says that no man can come to the Son unless the Father draws him. That is the Lord God himself drawing you to the knowledge and the revelation. He wants to reveal who his Son, Jesus Christ, is to you. The Bible says that if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that you will be saved. What are you saved from? We're saved from God's wrath because we're born in our sinful nature where we deserve death for our sins. But Jesus Christ paid the price for our death on the cross. And if we believe in that, the Bible says that we will save and we will live with him for eternity. I just gave you a long detail, but here's what it is, that you're saved from the penalty of sin. For God says that the penalty of sin is death. Jesus paid that price for us. I pray that you made that confession on today. If you did, heaven rejoices. I rejoice with you as well. That is not the end. That is not the end. You need to be a part of a Bible believing, Bible teaching, Bible living church. And we here at the Lighthouse, at the Pike, we would love to be that church for you. Now we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. So we're in this sanctification process as well. So we want to work with you. We want to be a part of your life. We want to be a part of your family. However, this may not be the choice of the church of your choosing, and we would still like to help you or assist you in that process to find a place that you feel comfortable at. Would you send us an email if that is you to the Lighthouse on the Pike? No, info@thelighthouseonthepike.org. Again, that's info@thelighthouseonthepike.org, and someone will assist you expeditiously. Secondly, I thank God for you and your continuous giving. And your continuous giving is because your obedience to him that we're able to have this equipment, to have these lights on, in order to pay for this platform, in order to get this gospel message out. It is because your obedience to him. And I pray that you will continue to do so. If this is your first time giving, here's how you can do so. You can do it one of three ways. First, you can visit our website, and the address is thelighthouseonthepike.org, thelighthouseonthepike.org, and click on the giving tab. Secondly, you can give by way of the Cash App, and our Cash App is the cash tag, the $ Lighthouse on the Pike. Again, via the Cash App, our cash tag is $ Lighthouse on the Pike. Or if you just want to give by mail, you can do so as well. Our address is the Lighthouse on the Pike, 5904 Marlboro Pike, District Heights, Maryland, 207-47. Wow, that's all I have for you. I'm losing my voice. I got so excited. I promise you, I'm about to stay here. I just want to read this all over again. I might even preach to myself all over again. But no, that is all I have for you. Remember, I just recently started saying it, but if you're watching this broadcast now, share the information, tell somebody about it. But we also rebroadcast our 11 o'clock message that's on YouTube, and it's also linked to our website. But we rebroadcast it on Facebook, on the Lighthouse on the Pike Church via Facebook at 7 p.m. every Sunday. So this message right now will be rebroadcasted on Facebook, the Lighthouse on the Pike Church, at 7 p.m. And then I invite you all to visit us for our Bible study every Thursday at 7 p.m. And right now we are doing a complete Bible survey. We started at the book of Genesis last week. We just finished Malachi. This Thursday, we're going to go through the poetic books, those books being Job, Psalm, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon. We're going to cover those books this week, and then we'll jump right into the New Testament. So we're doing a Bible survey. So please come join us. We would love to have you. All I'm trying to do is just get out all the information possible to help us to be better Bible students, to be better Bible readers. So then we can live it out. We can live it out. But we need to first find out what this word says for ourselves. The days are over with, depending on what other people say, what other people tell us this means. And that even goes for you all who are listening to me, and I know I'm standing on the soapbox again. I would never intentionally mislead you, and I would never intentionally say something wrong, but I am fallible, which means that I can be wrong. So you need to know for yourself. The Bible says that Paul writes to Timothy to study, to show yourself approved as a workman that need not be ashamed before God, rightly dividing the word of truth. And just like Paul said that to Timothy, that still goes, that is still relevant for you and I today, that we as individuals need to study to show ourselves approved. Wow, that's all I have for you. I pray to see you all in the coming days. Now unto him who is able to present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise God be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forever. Let the people of God say amen.
He has done great things. Come on. He has done great things.